Welcome to Student Ministry That Matters. I'm Ben Trueblood, and today I want to talk to you about the things you need to do in the first 3 months at a new church. So here you are, either a new youth pastor or at a new church as a youth pastor, and I want to help you organize your first 3 months so that it is the most effective that it can be. So let's jump right in with a key phrase that I want you to remember, and that's cultural exegesis, right? Now, let me bring some definition for you. You've probably heard the term exegesis before, and the definition for that is a critical explanation or interpretation of a text. Most often scripture, at least in our world, is how we would define that. So then cultural exegesis is a critical explanation or interpretation of a culture. Now, here's why this is important in the first 3 months of you being at your new church. It's all about learning, okay? Your first 3 months can be described more than anything else about a learning period, a learning of your place, a learning of the people, and a learning of your programming that's already existing before you got there, okay? So, in order to do cultural exegesis, in order to critically explain and interpret your culture, you have to go where people gather. Now, gathering means something different than it did 6 months ago, at least at the time of filming of this. But you need to go where people are gathering in order to begin interpreting your culture. So just really practically, you need to spend some time at Walmart. If you don't have a Walmart, then you need to spend some time at Target. If you have both, then spend some time at both. Go where the people of your community go. And in a non-weird way, just kind of notice the people. Go and see who the people are that you're going to be ministering to. You can learn a lot by watching people, and it's not weird as long as you don't make it weird. So for cultural exegesis, you just have to begin to know the people. This might feel really uncomfortable to you, but it's okay to have conversations with people. As you're at the gas station and filling up your car and there's someone in the pump right across from you, it's okay to begin to engage conversations just to begin to get a feel of who the people are in your community. If you don't know who the people are, then you're never going to be able to relate to them or pastor them really well, all right? So go to places where people gather and then meet community leaders and ask them some specific questions about the community. So this can be faculty at schools. And this, just as a side note, as a youth pastor at a new church, one of the first things that you should do is begin meeting school administrators. And that not only helps you do the cultural exegesis piece we're talking about, but it puts a face with a name. And as you begin to seek more campus ministry in the future, they already know who you are. And so those doors can begin to open. Being able to say, hey, I'm the new youth pastor at, is a great introduction for you in a school. So as you're learning more about the community, meet school leaders, meet local business people, and people that have been at your church a long time can say, hey, these are some other business people from our community that go to our church. And that's a great place to start. And I would ask them questions about the community. Begin to hear their story. Maybe they grew up in this community and can shed light on maybe some of the struggles the community has had, some of the wins the community has had, and the unique role that the church plays in that specific community. All right. And then public officials. If you happen to have like school board people or state or national representatives from your church, then meet them as well, okay? They can be inform you as you develop this critical explanation and interpretation of your culture. So number one, spend that time doing cultural exegesis on your community. Number two, get to know people, all right? So if the first part is the place, the second part is the people. Now I want to rattle off the people that you need to spend some time getting to know in your first 3 months. Leaders in the ministry, okay? People who have been volunteering in student ministry before you got there, you need to begin to learn their names, learn their families, and get to know them, okay? They will be your partners in ministry, hopefully, for a really long time. So get to know the leaders, get to know the parents. Spend special time, devote time to spending with parents. A lot of places, not every place, but a lot of places when you come and do interviews, you'll meet with a small group of parents before you are introduced, or as you're introduced, kind of your first weekend, there'll be a meeting where you get to, you know, kind of rub shoulders with the parents, and it's not really a good time to get to know people. It's just saying, hey, and I'm the new person here. This goes beyond that to really begin to learn the family dynamics of the people in your ministry. And then students, obviously, okay? You want to get to know the teenagers in your ministry. Now, one idea that you can roll all three of these things into is by having small get-to-know-you gatherings at different places. So have somebody from the church help you identify some of the more involved parents of the ministry already and ask if they would be willing to host a get-to-know-you gathering for you as the new youth pastor. Show up at the house. You're going to be able to meet some leaders, parents, and students all in one shot. This is a great moment for you to begin to get to know people on a smaller level where you listen, where you ask questions like, what have you loved about student ministry here? Where do you see student ministry playing a role in our community? What would you like to see from student ministry? And to be able to listen, you earn credibility with this group of people right away. And again, that's a way that you can get to know leaders, parents, and students all at once through these small gatherings. Now, if you're watching this and you're not new to student ministry and you've been at your church for 10 years, and it's been a while since you've done these small gatherings like this, they're still a key part of your leadership too. To go back and gather together and say, okay, I may have been here for a while, but I'm not done listening to you. What do you think about student ministry? What could we do better? What are we doing well? Listening, putting yourself in a listening posture will speed the get-to-know-you process and earns you credibility for later on when you begin to want to make changes in the ministry. All right, so first is the place. Second is the people. Third is the programming. All right, now you are going to want to evaluate all of the programming that currently exists in your student ministry. Walk around with a pen and a notepad or put it in the notes app on your phone, but take notes on everything. Everything that you see, make a little note about it. I would change this. I love this. These people do a great job at this. Take notes on everything so that when you get to the point of making changes, you're ready to go. So that if you want to make a change, and you do the work of asking people's opinions who are already in the ministry, you have notes to be able to talk clearly about the things that you want to change, all right? Speaking of change, be slow to make sweeping changes. In your first 3 months, be slow to make sweeping changes. You can make small tweaks. Be willing to do that as you go. So slow for the sweeping changes, but be willing to make small tweaks as you see them. You do not want to be in the situation where you come in and in the first 3 months completely change the entire ministry. That has worked very, very few times. I've talked to a lot of student pastors who have started at a lot of churches, and I don't know of one off the top of my head where changing the entire ministry in the first 3 months ended up being a good thing for that student pastor. There may be one out there, but I haven't met them yet. So if you know them, or if you are them, let me know in the comments. I would love to hear your story. But be slow in making sweeping changes and be willing to make little tweaks along the way. And as you think about changes, refer to those notes and do your research with people before you change anything. Now, this isn't getting approval from people, but it's using those relationships to learn and make the best decision possible. When you're new, you're not a knowledge expert on the student ministry at that specific church. You may have been around student ministry for decades, but you're at a new place. And while there are some transferable principles, you need to remember that you're not a knowledge expert on student ministry in that specific context. So you need help. That's when you reach out to students, parents, leaders, other staff members to learn so that you can make the best possible decision as you go to change things. All right, so places, people, programming, and this last one, pastors. Okay? You're going to want to take time to get to know the pastors at the church, the other staff members. Now, that'll vary depending on your context and how many people that is, but whoever they are, get to know them and begin being part of the team. Because you are not just there to do student ministry, you're there to reach the community as part of an overall team. The last thing that I would mention to you is to avoid the "you only start once" mentality. Okay? Avoid the mentality of "you only start once, you have to nail it and be perfect." Here's the truth. You're not going to be perfect. And that's okay. But when we constantly drive ourselves by, I have one chance to do this the right way the first time. I have one chance to start. I have one chance to do these 3 months. When that drives us and is our primary motivator, then that can creep into our mindset and actually be really discouraging at the mistakes that we make along the way. You're not going to be perfect, and that's okay. No one's asking you to be perfect in this moment. The good news is Jesus was already perfect, so you don't have to be. And so I don't have to be. When we avoid the "you only start once" mentality, it actually gives us freedom to be able to discover and learn the place, the people, and the programming that God has put in front of us to lead well with in our calling to student ministry. I would love to hear some other things that you would do or have done in your first 3 months of ministry. If you would put those in the comments, I would love to read those and learn from you. Here is a part of student ministry that matters. If you would, like and subscribe on your way out, and we'll see you on the next video.